Hello everyone, I'm the Holy Hermit, and this is the long-awaited podcast that almost never happened. This one's going to be special, guys, because I've got two guests with me, and as I always play this little game, you have to kind of figure out who they are. So guys, don't say your name, by the way. Let's play this game, and I'm pretty sure about 99% of you will know who these are. And if you don't know, then please just stop playing Diablo, guys. Come on, you need to know these guys. So here we go. Let's start with the monk guy. I mean, I know you play monk. I mean, I know you're Paragon 5 or 6 or something. You're a noob, man, but please say something about yourself, sir.
Well, I'm a main monk streamer player that streams on Twitch TV pretty much every day.
And monk, what would your Paragon be, sir?
My Paragon, I think it's 1302.
Yeah, guys, so that's like 1,000 more than mine, and if you haven't figured out already, this gentleman, this amazing guy here, monk streamer, he's called Matsuma, and if you are living under a rock, please get out, do check this guy out. So let's put a little plug in the beginning, and we're going to shut up, by the way. But this legend is monk, and he's not surpassed, he's equally matched by another guy who is amazing storyteller, and he's amazing at making builds, and he does so many amazing things. He likes to wear a suit of armor. He's got little unicorns and race cars at the back of his room. We found out recently, by the way. And, sir, please do say something about yourself.
Well, I have started out as a crusader. I've started branching out recently into basically all the classes. But as you said, I do take interest in more than just the game. There's also the lore side, race cars, and recently cooking, which has shortened my Twitch presence, but that's besides the point.
There we go. So if you don't know who he is, guys, he is none other than our MVP on EU forums. That's Mr. Deadset here. So I'm lucky enough to have both of these guys here with me on this collaborative adventure of ours, so to speak. So it's going to be a podcast. It's going to be more of a banter, really, a chat with friends. That's all it's going to be. And that's what we want you guys to get out of it. Because so many people ask us all this time, you know, I'll see some comments here and there. Are there people who play Diablo? Do they sit down ever and talk about things and would like to know their opinion? So I'm more of an idiot, like ignore me for most of the time, but I do have very amazing and experienced players with me. So today for the hour or the 2 hour, whatever time we take, see, that's how unofficial we are, by the way, you know, whatever time we take, we're going to be talking about the state of game and how things are. So I'm going to jump back to our guest now, Mr. Natsuma, sir. So let's take this to a personal level. Come on, let's get, you know, intimate in a very strange way, but in a nice way. And that is, I would like to know who you are, sir, right? I mean, we all know you play Monk, and it's been an amazing thing. You are one of the most hardcore players I've ever had the privilege of knowing. But who is Natsuma in general? How did you start with Diablo? Tell us a little bit about yourself, sir.
Well, the first contact I got with Diablo was a friend of mine, and he played a game called Diablo II. Let's just go back into the past. And I was extremely fascinated by the game because it was unlike anything I played before. It was, first of all, a PC game. I was not very familiar yet with PC games because we did not own a very powerful computer. I was more of a PlayStation 1 kind of, you know, and that kind of area, and Nintendo 64. So I was really intrigued with how it worked. And for some reason, just to be able to kill a mob and get this piece of armor that could be anything was extremely fascinating. So I got really kind of involved in the game from the get-go, and I could only play on his PC, unfortunately, until the time I managed to scramble a PC together that fortunately could handle Diablo 2. And ever since then, it was pretty much love at first sight when it came to the ARPG genre. And it started with Diablo 2. And of course, when the infamous Tristram guitar sound was released, I think it was BlizzCon several years ago. And well, from that point on, it was the longest wait ever. Of course, the hype for, sorry?
Wasn't it 2008?
It could be. It could very well be.
Somewhere around that time, for sure.
Yeah. That was the infamous Tristram guitar sound that Diablo III was
finally going to be, you know,
was
released.
Finally going to be released. Of course, the hype with that was amazing, and every day I would go to Diablo fans or Diablo subreddit to check for that release date or any sort of information or glimpse of the box. And this is kind of a funny story. When Diablo III released, I had a really important exam. Just my luck, right?
Okay.
I was actually thinking of skipping the thing.
I know where this is going, but please carry on.
But in the end, you know, my better judgment was like, you know, you should really go and do the test and just play the game with some good feelings. Right? So I went to school and I got back, and luckily I was just, you know, everybody was waiting. Uh-huh. An infamous error code. So unfortunately, fortunately, nothing was lost at playtime. And well, since that day, I can't really remember much because sleep wasn't very, you know,
important.
A thing when Diablo III released, and it was amazing. And by on and offs, because I did not start streaming until Reaper of Souls Season 1.
Okay.
Even though I've been playing the game for, well, up to that point.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, when Reaper of Souls released, it was an amazing experience. And especially the remove of the auction house was an extremely important function or a feature. I'm actually going to call it a feature, the removal, to keep my interest in Diablo 3 peaked. And of course, the announcement of the seasons was just, Diablo 3 officially kind of started for me.
Awesome. So is it safe to say, like, you were playing the game from day one, right?
You were
the one who probably farmed, like me, Act 1 butcher runs, and then when you could do
Goblin
that,
runs.
You went to Act 3.
Yes, nice. Went to Act 2, cried, re-rolled a Demon Hunter. You know, it's kind of how everything went back in those days, the infamous Sand Wasps. It was pretty much just making a monk, cry yourself to sleep in Act 2, make Demon Hunter, do Act 3, farm gear for your monk, and then I'm still not being able to do Act 2. That's pretty much how it went back then. Yeah.
Good times, huh?
Good times, very.
Yeah. So, Mr. Deadset, so what about you? I want to know the same answer. I know it's the same question, but I really am intrigued. To me, the start of a player is everything, you know. The story, the history is what makes you who you are. And I've got a couple of awesome questions for you, I think, later on, which are going to tie into this whole thing. So where does the journey begin? When did you start? What was this whole idea, you know? Playing a game like Diablo, where most people would say it's a repetitive task and all these things, but here you are, one of the top players, one of the top crusaders, well known in the community, and you're branching out, as you said. So where did all of this start? So give us a pre-crusader Deadset. How was he, you know, when he was driving the race cars? I want to know that crusader.
Sometime in, I think, 2000, it should be.
Okay.
I picked up a computer magazine, very popular at the time. For PC games, and it had this barbarian guy on the cover, huge axe, you know, naked to the waist, looking kind of menacing. He had slaughtered, obviously, quite a few monsters around him, and it piqued my interest. The article for the game was glowing, you know, top to bottom. I don't think I had seen up until then an article that gave such a glowing review. So naturally, I was interested. And at the time, at least in my country, which is Bulgaria, kind of PC bangs, internet cafes type of business joints, I guess, were very popular. So this was basically the place to go if you want to play computer games. Personal computers were not very popular in the country at the time. So Diablo being a very, I guess, LAN-oriented and LAN kind of friendly game. Very, very cool for partying up and kind of being around with friends and spending time in it. It was a natural fit for such places, so I could easily check it out basically the month after I saw the article. And it was, yeah, love at first sight, for sure.
Great, so that was Diablo 2, right?
Yeah, I don't think any ARPG gamer can properly explain why he loves it, but he does.
Yeah.
So,
Definitely.
If you try to explain it to a normal person, it doesn't make sense either. But it does once you get into it. Anyway, I guess later on I checked out Diablo 1. I was too young at the time of release. I guess it was 1997. So,
Safe for
sure.
Me.
I checked it out later. Appreciated it for what it was. I think actually the last time that I played the classics was around the release of Vanilla to get myself pumped up for the release of Diablo 3. Actually, unlike Natsuma though, I was not really following the development all that closely, so I guess I kind of just jumped into it as a last minute decision, I almost didn't fall into the hype. I don't know how.
Oh, I guess
I had been away from the game for so long. Yeah, definitely from the classic. Yeah. And just a couple of friends were still very much into it and were basically hyping it to me. I guess if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't have even been here. So, yeah.
Oh, I have to thank your friends.
I fell back into it. Special thanks to them. I fell back into it much harder than they did, actually. So, I guess this was Diablo 3 Vanilla for me. Basically, from May 2012 onwards, it has been Diablo pretty much
as your
a huge
game.
Percentage of the time. Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
You didn't get the hype banners then?
Mm-hmm. No, that's not a, really. Oh, no
banners? Oh, man.
Mm-mm.
Mm.
Wow. So, that's the beauty, right? Two different guys. Like, I mean, both of your stories, you both love the game. I guess we all do. That's why we're sitting here talking and people would be listening to it. But you started with the whole hype train, Natsuma. You knew all about, you were following it. And Mr. Deadset kind of stumbled upon it, you know, refound the love, rekindled the flame, so to speak. And
it was,
you know,
probably way better for Deadset, though, because I had to wait years.
True. Absolutely.
And he just kind of like, oh, it's released. You know,
oh, so. Diablo 3, huh? Let's check it out.
Yeah, cool.
Okay, well, let's talk about a little side point here. It just came to me. So that's a big thing, right? If you talk to the so-called veteran, and I am like raising my hands in the air quotes, so to speak, people when the game came out complained about the graphics and all these things, right? How Diablo 2 was dark, dank, and, you know, gothic style action RPG, whereas Diablo 3 was a bit more on the colorful side. So Natsuma, you were the guy who played a lot before and who were eagerly waiting, and so did Mr. Deadset, but, you know, you were following the whole hype thing. Did it affect your decision to play the game? Was that like a big deciding factor, or were you all concerned just about how the loot's going to be, how the game's going to play out? So did that have any effect on your like decision making?
Well, I remember it just popped to my head that I actually had a glimpse of the Diablo 1.
Mm-hmm.
Seeing it at my nephew's place, he's quite older than me, and I remember just seeing the game, and I think he was fighting Butcher. And for me, it was like a horror movie at that point. And Diablo 2 was dark and a little bit mysterious. But Diablo 3 wasn't that much mysterious or dark or gothic.
Mm-hmm.
But for some reason, it didn't bother me that much because I was just more interested at that point in how the combat was very fluent, I felt.
Yes, yeah, without a doubt.
Yeah, compared to Diablo 2, of course technology changes, and mm-hmm. some would still argue that Diablo 2 combat is more in-depth than Diablo 3, but you cannot argue that just the smoothness of the skills and stuff
fluidity,
like that, it's great. And I just really wanted a game that I could spend a lot of time in and just get items that could be good or bad. Like, I wanted to find that one legendary that nobody had, or, you know, not even to sell on the real money auction house. It was just more of that kind of accomplishment feeling, I guess. Like, what made Diablo 3 for me, just finding that item or playing with friends and being able to find that item that your friends want. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
It was just...
No, I understand. More for you, it was more of a social experience, but more
into
you know, the loot finding, the nitty-gritty bit, you know. The colors on the screen are good and all, but at the end of the day, you know, it was, you know.
It's about that loot rush.
And see, that's why I asked the question, Natsuma, right? I will get to that in a second, but think about it, right? You are a guy who is, like, striving very hard right now to be at the top of the leaderboard, and you are, right? So you have that competitive spirit that a player, you know, finds. And that's why I asked the question, see? So right from the get-go, you didn't care how it looked like, and, you know, you didn't care, you know, whether this color was too bright or this wasn't. For you, it was all about getting that sweet loot.
Yeah,
and
just having fun at the game. I do see it, and some people would, like, if you, for instance, go to the pony level, like, why is that there?
Mm-hmm.
Or, like, for some reason, if you actually walk through the Act 1 dungeons before Butcher, there are a lot of people spiked on the wall with, like, bloody gore or just, like, people in cages. But for some reason, it just didn't really...
Yeah, it didn't
frighten me or did something with me, but maybe that comes with age.
Mm-hmm.
It's also, I was very young with Diablo 1.
Oh, yeah.
With Diablo 2, I was much younger. I didn't know much about the game, which made it more mysterious. But maybe for Diablo 3, I pretty much know everything there is in the game, as in the items. Like, there's no... Never it happens that an item drops and I'm like, oh, okay, I never knew this item existed, because because of all the research, and just I guess that makes it a lot less mysterious and a lot less.
No, that's great. Let's ask Deadset now. So, my friend, the same question goes for you, I guess, is the way the game came out to be, you weren't expecting much. You knew this game existed and you loved the previous versions. You know, you loved the prequels, if you want to put it that way. The game came out. Did it have any impact on, you know, how you initially thought of it? Were you sad by it? Were you happy? Or was it, you know, hey, you know, I like farming loot. Like, what was the whole idea? What was going through your mind, if you can recall that for us? It'll be, you know, I'd love to know that, so...
Well, from an artistic standpoint, I guess I never came to Diablo to get scared.
Mm-hmm.
So, in that sense, it did not bother me either. And I do appreciate stylized games. I do appreciate the art side of things. So,
mm-hmm.
I think I liked the way it turned out,
okay.
even despite losing a lot of its, I guess, old-school grittiness.
Mm-hmm.
But really, I think Diablo 2 also is not nearly as dark as Diablo 1 was.
Oh, no.
So,
I would agree with you, yeah.
Yeah, it's actually not that surprising to me, or at least it wasn't at the time. And as Nats pointed out, if you do look at certain details, you'll notice a lot of dark fantasy themes. There is certainly, it certainly has its fair share of gore, certainly has its fair share of evilness and darkness and such, but I guess it's stylized in a way that doesn't really scare you. And I don't think that's the point of the game either way. So, yeah, I would say I liked it at the time, and I still do.
Yeah. And the physics are amazing in the game.
To their credit, actually, Reaper of Souls does actually
go back
strike me
dark.
As a little darker than any of the other acts.
They listened all right. I mean, that was such a great thing. I mean, out of the 100 different things they did great with Reaper of Souls, that's definitely, you know, one of the things there. So, and see, like, that's why, guys, you know, I'm trying to, and this is me, like, doing one of those, you know, Jeremy Kyle or whatever show, basically, that we are an awesome Diablo family. And I'm just trying to, you know, like, get it out there that you two guys, you know, again, stay different ways you started the game, but you both loved the game for what it was and what it is. And that's just killing monsters and finding loot. And, you know, not about how it looks and all. I mean, don't get me wrong. I still remember, as you talked about physics, I would like to make a point. The first video I saw when they showed, was it Cathedral level 1 or something? I think so. When Barbarian was fighting Leoric.
Yeah.
And the way Barbarian would hit someone with a lightning axe and you'd see their body parts flying.
Mm-hmm.
And it sounds gruesome. And you'd see lightning arc between them. I mean, physics of that is so good, and you don't appreciate it if you only play Diablo. If you play certain other games like Diablo, and you come back to Diablo, you realize how fluid everything is, you know? The way Barbarian moves, I mean, the way a monk charges, and the way, you know, a crusader bashes with that shield. There's a certain, you know, punch to it, if you will. I mean, there's a certain impact
nice,
that you can feel. And that's great with the game. So, we've talked about your start, guys. So let's talk about a little bit about, we're not going to go too much into detail, but about the vanilla experience you had. So how did it go for you, Natsuma? Anything special you did over there? What was the most memorable part you remember?
Dying to Act 2 Bees. No, seriously. When me and my friend started, because I started with a friend group, everybody wanted to fire lasers, wanted to summon creatures. And I was like, you know what? I just want to hit stuff in the face. So I went with the monk. And for some reason, I kind of wanted to experience every class, because if you play a game, it's really nice to kind of go from A, B, C, and check everything out. I've played every class.
Mm-hmm.
But for some reason, I just played monk and I just dashed with it. And it just like a flame kick, and I started summoning bells. And I was like, you know what?
Yeah,
this is pretty damn awesome.
Mm-hmm.
So I went, I just went with my group, and we just did stuff. And at some point, I really kind of felt the experience that monk was very underpowered at the time, especially because I remembered the what's the demon hunter skill again that you go invulnerable for a while? Is that
which one? Ambush right now, you mean?
No, it's the spell. Smokescreen, exactly.
Smokescreen
had like a 6 second duration or something.
Oh, yeah. At the start, it was pretty
ridiculous.
Crazy.
It was amazing. It was fixed the first week, I think. But I was talking to a friend of mine. He was like, yeah, dude, I'm just doing act 3. And I'm like, okay, I'm killing goblins on act 1. What's going on? And so there was a clear difference in the power between classes, but that was fine with the early stages, and stuff got fixed. As people know, monks get overpowered, then other classes get overpowered. So it was very much at the start of vanilla. If you didn't play a demon hunter, you weren't gonna have a good time. But stubborn Natsuma just kept playing monk, man, farming those goblins.
Yeah, with 20k sheet damage, I bet.
Oh,
yes.
Oh, man. Them escaping. Yep. The goblin galore.
Sadness.
You, at some point, you know, after 4 or 5 hours of grinding, would find maybe one decent rare. Yeah, we're talking rares, because legendaries were absolute, well,
they were non-existent. And
they were. I was actually upset when I found a legendary, because I just knew it was going to be a disappointment.
Do you remember what it was, if I may ask?
My first legendary. Yes. That was the Monster Hunter.
Oh, okay.
Sword. Yeah, it was like I was level 20. Uh-huh. And it was amazing. But after, when you hit level 60, it was just... But that got fixed later, thank God. But I found this yellow pair of pants, I still remember. And they just rolled everything. I think they had, like... I think it was still possible to get, like, our resist and physical resist on it. You know, it was just completely broken. So I sold that on the auction house, got myself enough gear from that to go to Act 2, and that's where I really, you know, met my nightmare.
That's how you became a millionaire, you know, for a couple of minutes when you got sold at the auction house.
But Act 2 is also how I went from monk to demon hunter. And I just played demon hunter to gear my monk. So eventually I managed to get my monk to Act 3, Act 4, and getting the first Diablo kill of my friends. So that was
nice. So what about you, Deadset, my friend? Any old memories from vanilla? Anything you fondly remember or not so fondly?
Oh, for sure. I do remember it quite vividly. So seeing that I guess interestingly, even though I kind of got the word out for myself as a Crusader, being kind of a logical progression from the Paladin of Diablo 2, I actually pretty much exclusively played Sorceress in Diablo 2.
All right, okay.
Throughout. And I actually started vanilla with a wizard. So I was one of the shooty lightning and lasers kind of guy, as Nats pointed out. So I guess at the time I was pretty on top of exploits.
Hey, this is a public podcast. We don't admit these things.
So I think I used the same one that Creep used for his clear.
Okay.
For hardcore. But yeah, I did use
the
same one.
The wizard immortality thing with the life regen.
Yes, yes. In a way, it was life after a kill. And every time you resummoned Hydra, it applied your life after kill. So you just spammed a lot of Hydras. And you kind of healed yourself back up to full life. But yeah, it was a pretty horrible experience to try and do that. I don't recommend it to anyone. Actually, you can't recommend it to anyone because it's long gone, of course. But it's a funny memory. It's not exactly a pleasant gaming experience, no.
Yeah, no. Wizard had a lot of bad like exploits going on.
The energy armor one, then the Hydra one.
Yeah, there was an immortality one. If you like managed to fire a certain skill in an order, then it just you wouldn't die.
Oh yeah, it was a little
Archon,
later.
Right?
Yep. Exactly.
I think I did that too as well for just for experimental purposes.
Yeah.
Okay?
No, same here. I gave it a shot. I was like, okay, this is cool, but my wizard just was terrible at the time. So I just, you know what? Never mind. Let's go back to farming goblins.
So Deadset, would it be safe to assume that, you know, like, yeah, you played that, but your real calling was Crusader? Does that explain why you started your amazing YouTube career, you know, when with the Crusader, you became the Crusader guy? Because the guy resonated with you, right? I mean, there was something about that class.
That is true. I've always enjoyed kind of the mage knights in video games.
Okay.
Heavily armored, but still able to cast spells. So basically, the Crusader was that, really. Mm-hmm. Even more so than the Paladin is, really.
Yep.
Less reliance on auras and more on flashy skills, I guess. So, yeah, I guess the Crusader did grab me because of that. And I guess if you look at the way I've played the game, it's pretty much either a lot of wizardy stuff or a lot of Crusadery stuff. So,
okay.
I guess part of the spellcasting part always stuck with me. So, yeah, I guess that's how I began with Reaper of Souls, really. I just decided that it's about time I did something more than just talk about the game with real life friends, I always kind of felt that I needed to share my passion, and I decided now is the time.
Great.
It's now or never.
So you wanted to, you know, you were a guy who likes to cast spells, who likes flashy things and sports cars. We'll get to that joke, by the way, guys.
Oh,
guys, like, race cars.
Oh,
so
those sport cars. Oh,
that's great. That's awesome, man. So yeah, so gonna carry on with that. So you made an amazing YouTube channel, and the first time you started, and I can slightly relate to that because at some point I started a while ago as well. It's kind of daunting and scary, isn't it, Deadset? So what was the first video? What did you talk about? Any memory that you have of that? You know, what made you make? See, it's very hard, I think, personally, to pick up a mic, and in a way, we're gamers. We're all slightly introverts. You know, we like to live in our own world. And things out there look nice in the real world. We participate every now and then, but you know, we like our own bubble and we do things there. So to pick up a mic, record a video, talk about something is, I think, pretty brave in some way. I really do think so. And I think it's further accentuated and, you know, multiplied and amplified if you actually stream that to me. So, you know, how was your first experience, Deadset? Like, how did it go about?
I think I talked about an exploit. This is embarrassing. Oh, God.
Oh, my God. We are digging
some
dirt today.
This up.
Nice.
No. Mm-hmm. It shouldn't be that. I'm pretty sure it's actually something really decent at the time. I think I was talking about barbarians, actually, and kind of the death of the old Warwind spec and where it should go from there. Of course, that's super old stuff, no longer relevant in any shape or form, but
yeah.
Yeah, I think a guide was the first one, so at least I'm free of guilt that it's not about exploits.
Are we talking here about like the end of vanilla starter Reaper of Souls?
Mm-hmm. Actually, even pre-Reaper of Souls, like right about the time that patch 2.0 hits and a lot of the loot 2.0 changes hit. So basically a lot of the builds flew out of the window because of it.
Yeah, okay, all right, I remember that time. So that's when, you know, Deadset was born. That's pretty amazing, man. So
yeah, I started with loot 2.0 actually before Reaper of Souls for sure.
And what about you, Natsuma, my friend? Because I know Idiot Me used to stream a long time ago, and my friend Natsuma didn't used to stream then, because we'd probably been friends that time then, you know, because you're that kind of guy. But from my knowledge, you started kind of recently, right? I mean, you have not been streaming since the beginning of Diablo. So what made you get to that point? Because we have talked about your vanilla experience, and I'm pretty certain you started somewhere in the Reaper of Souls era, kind of that area-ish, right? So how did that came to be? And more importantly, what made you pick up a nice microphone and a camera and talk to people on Twitch stream? And, you know, how was the whole experience? Do share it with us, please.
Show that beautiful face.
The start. Well, I'm a big Twitch TV kind of fan. Like, I always, when I play a game, I like to watch streams to kind of pick up on the best strategies or, you know, what's the best way to play. I'm kind of a very efficient kind of person that if I play a game, it's kind of like a perfectionist fault at times. Sometimes helps me. It helps me in Diablo 3, but in other times it doesn't help me. I want to kind of find out what is the best way to play and do kind of stuff.
Okay.
So I was looking at streams and we're talking mods and Invis and Moses and, you know, all the kind of, there are tons more. And I was looking at this and I was thinking to myself, wow, that's the dream, dude. Like being able to play video games, have a community, and just to stream, that must be the best thing ever. But you know, I was busy with my studies. I was like, ah, man, that's not for me. I will never be able to keep keep that going, and it takes a lot of effort. Like I could see I could see streaming was an all fun in games because it's very easy to kind of, oh, he's just playing video games. But you could see that it takes time, it takes energy. So I kind of let that go, and at the start of Reaper of Souls, or I should say at the start of season one, I found myself with a lot of free time on my hands because my studies were kind of on a break there, and so I thought to myself, you know what, let's give it a shot. You know, like I wanna just give that to myself, that at least tried once to kind of get a stream going, even though I knew that thousands and thousands of people try and don't succeed.
Yeah.
And I kind of wanted to at least give it a shot before saying, no, I'm not able to do it. And a big part of why I wanted to start streaming kind of sounds sad, but I didn't have a lot of friends in Diablo 3 that were playing the damn game anymore.
Okay.
All my friends from Vanillas quit the game already.
You still don't.
Wow, burn. So I wanted to make a community. I was playing with people in communities and stuff, and I was kind of building up friends, but I really wanted to make a community for people that love Diablo 3 and just want to play it a little bit more efficiently than most people, I would say.
Okay.
Because a lot of my friends were like, I'm just playing the game, I don't really care. But I was more of a person that kind of wants to go into depth of things and figuring out the best way to farm. And they weren't really interested in that, so I was really missing that. So I kind of wanted to do something with that. So I popped on my stream, and the first 8 hours were a ton of fun talking to me, myself, and I.
Okay.
And, yeah.
Do you remember your first viewer, Natsuma? That's the question. Do you remember someone coming in and typing a comment? Do you remember?
Yes. Yes.
I think I know the story too.
My first actual viewer that came in
was
the first guy. And the thing he said that my video quality sucked. Dick.
That's the amazing Twitch chat. Ever been nice to you?
That was my first viewer. And you know what? Holy hermit, I could not have been more happy, because at that point, right, second day, it's the second day of talking 7 hours straight to myself, because I watched some YouTube videos here and there, you know, how to start streaming. And they said, you know what, always keep talking, because when somebody comes into your stream and they see somebody sitting there not doing anything particularly interesting and not saying anything, why would they stick around? So that sounded logical. So he said to me, oh, your quality sucks. I'm like, dude, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with me. And he was kind of like, the fuck, you know, what's going on? And he actually helped me with my video quality. And then I said, I'm sorry, my accent's kind of weird. And some other guys, no, dude, your accent is just fine. And I was like almost crying at this point, you know. It was like, oh my God, dude, my chat, there are two people in here. On top of the world, my community.
Yeah.
And then I was really lucky to find a good item, a flying dragon. You know, the Daibo, the monk Daibo. It's currently again in the flavor.
Yep.
In the most of the builds out there, and it was surprisingly well rolled. So you know, I thought I heard somewhere interesting titles are important. So I put it into my title. Good flying dragon or something like that. I can't remember. So, you know, people started coming in and wanted to see my flying dragon. And that's, of course, you can say the flying D. So, you know, all kinds of sexual jokes arose from that. And like showing my D on stream, whatever. people liked that. They stayed. And at some, like really slowly, I started to build a community from there. And people stayed. People came back. I was one of the lucky ones that actually kind of built a small community within a week. To like 30 viewers a day. And that jumped to 70, that jumped to 30 back. And I remember a fellow monk streamer, well, used to stream Hacks, D3, gave me a host at some point. It was really awesome. And streaming every day, being out there on the leaderboards and just, you know, getting that follow a day at some point just came to be as people coming back, returning more followers. And that's just how you grow as a streamer. You have to be consistent. Great. With your times, you have to show interesting gameplay, because why should people watch you over somebody more popular than you? Just stuff like that. And I must say I was one of the lucky ones, because I know people that deserve more viewers than they're currently getting.
Well, I understand the deserve part, but I'll have to interject, man. I don't know if you were like, I think you are right where you should be, because you worked hard. I mean, I do believe in destiny and all that. Maybe that thing is true, but I think the fact that you're mentioning to me, you know, you had two viewers and you started working hard and, you know, you did everything right and, you know, you worked hard on it, basically, to put it in a simple way, is what you got you there. So that's really good, man, you know, because both of you are people who are on the creativity side of things, right? There are people who do things, who follow things, and there are people who make things, and both of them are very important in the world, and you are the guys, obviously, who make things. So like you said, you would stream for 7 hours and you have to come up with things that are interesting, and Deadset would have to make a video. I know Deadset's work. He would have to write an amazing script. Everything has to be well in order. The video has to be edited. I mean, this thing takes time. I mean, it takes a lot of time and it takes a lot of effort. And when you start, you don't have the following, you don't have the love behind you. And all you're doing it is out of your, you know, the will to do something good. You know, there's no viewers or nothing like that in your mind. All you want to do is do a good job. And I think that's pretty amazing, man. So, you know.
Thanks.
Yeah, please carry on.
Well, at that point, I think it was the season one drought, because the season one lasted, 6 months?
Something like that.
Or more. And I remember also coming into contact with Deadset at the end of season one. I think I threw you a host at some point and we started talking. I remember once coming to your chat when you didn't know me, and I was desperately trying to explain you how Monk works.
Yeah,
and it's just, it couldn't come across because there was, whatever. But we started we were pretty much the only people, well, not, there were more, but streaming still in the Diablo season one drought.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A lot of the so-called, the bigger streamers went to either, I think Path of Exile got a new expansion or whatever. And that also really helped the viewers because they saw me every day. So people that still wanted to watch Diablo 3, we're talking 150 viewers at the top spot of Twitch at the time. So it was quite, you know, dead, you could call it, but you were still there. You were still out there. And that really helped as well for the season two jump, because the season two jump was great. And my season three jump was the best jump I've ever had in viewers and followers.
And hopefully it'll continue, man, for both of you guys.
I hope so.
Nice. So there we go, guys. I think that's the awesome story. So that's how you both became friends. Because I know, if you don't know, guys, Natsume and, you know, Deadset kind of know each other, and all these jokes they're throwing at each other, you know, they know each other. So that's the thing. So that's pretty amazing, guys. You both have awesome stories, I think. But I want to know a little bit more, you know, I think the other side of Diablo now. Now, we all know how you started, how you came to be, and the level at which you play Diablo, which is, fair to say, guys, not to be, you know, to be very frank, is very high. You know, it's up there. All of you guys, like you and me, we play Diablo, we might take a break, but these guys are the actual pros who put a lot of time and sweat and blood and tears and all the good stuff into the game, and they are actually, you know, successful at what they do. So that's great. So next part of the podcast for us three doing this would be to get to know their views about certain current trends in the game, how the game has evolved, and where things are going. So let's start with the little topic right now, guys. Is, I think all of us might agree on this one and might not, basically, but I'm going to throw it out there, and that is how farming works in Diablo 3, right? Because at the core of it, as we mentioned earlier, why Natsume started, why Deadset started, it's because of the beauty of the items, something that you enjoy. Finding a loot is always cool. And that's been the core experience for Diablo 3 since the beginning, you know, when the game came out, Diablo 1 times, right? So nothing's changed in Diablo 3, but you find loot, and you find loot at three different levels, and that's what I would like to call it, is the normal farming, which will be up till Torment 5 or something, where you just started your character, you look for items, anything you find, you strap it on, and hey, it looks nice, and you're happy at that time, because it doesn't matter what skill you equip, because the difficulty you're playing at is so low that everything and anything would work. If a Crusader wants to use Falling Sword, he can. If he wants to use Bombardments, that's going to work too. A Monk can actually use Inner Sanctuary. A Monk can use anything else he wants, you know. Everything's fine and every class is golden. So that's the initial period. But as soon as you start finding more items, you get those lovely sets, you move to Torment 6. And that's where kind of the start of the farming, the real farming begins, where you start to get those set items, complete the set, maybe get a good weapon in your gear. If you're lucky, you might get an ancient version, strap that gear on, and then you jump on to the Greater Rift. So I have talked about this in the past quite a few times, how T6 and Greater Rift are supposed to be played and how we play them. But to put it, we're not going to go there. We're just going to, the point of this whole talk is to actually just talk about these three different tiers of how farming exists and how things are. So the question to you guys now would be, is the three tiers that I've explained, I guess, to our viewers here and what we want to talk about, is, what do you think about these? Are they at a good spot right now for you as a player, you know, as whatever level of Diablo you play at, the high level of, you know, farming and doing amazing things and being at high Paragon level? Do you think farming items, is it balanced? Do you think one stage takes too long, the other one doesn't take too long, or the climbing curve is too steep? I hope you're getting my point where I'm going with this, guys.
Sure. So I think so, yeah.
Yeah, it's more of an open talk. I guess we all three can talk right now. So please feel free to jump in. So what are your thoughts on this, guys? Like, what do you think about, like, how you start a character? Do you think it's it's a good way to get up there. Any thoughts on that, guys?
You want to take this first, Deadset?
Sure. I've always maintained, I think for quite some time now, that Diablo suffers from what I would call difficulty bloat. There's a lot of difficulties, with quite a few of them being easily passed by, I guess, and people don't really spend any time in them, circumvent them in a lot of clever and actually intuitive ways. So I guess the game difficulty slider at least represents or is maybe broken down into too many sections, which could be confusing for a new player, but are definitely obtuse and unnecessary for more experienced ones too. If I can criticize something, I would start there, that the difficulty is fragmented so much that it might fragment the community as well and impact the availability of players around your skill level and around your gear level because of it.
So kind of PTR makes that worse with Torment 10.
There's even more difficulties now, which I'm not sure
Would be okay. So
would
yeah,
be
Natsuma, what would you add on to that,
necessary.
my friend? Yeah, like that Deadset made a great point of, you know, how everything's fragmenting now, and the three tiers I talked about might not be three tiers anymore, you know? We might have one or two more tiers being added there. So any thoughts on the first tier? Like, do you think the starting of a character, of how you initially get some items and get that little push going, especially if you're a new player. And I think that's something, especially, you know, Deadset and I, we are part of the forums, and you are a big representative on Twitch. Like, you show pro players how to do things, but we also welcome new guys into Diablo. I think that's like an important responsibility, if you will, for us guys to show how amazing and accessible the game is. So, how is the game meta, so to speak, Natsuma? Do you think the starting of the game is good, or?
Well, I agree with that said, with that there are a lot of difficulties. Kind of back in vanilla, there was the monster power thing, and they reduced that, and now they made it again to how that used to be instead of just making Torment 6 harder. But for me, as a person who always likes to play efficiently, I know pretty much exactly where to play at what level. I mean, when you hit level 1, you start one difficulty higher than normal, because that's just the best experience to time efficiency. Because I think the first jump is 75% experience from normal to, is it hard? I'm pretty sure it's hard or expert.
Normal is hard,
I
I
always mix
think.
those two.
It's hard.
And the next step is 75% to 100. So that's already a weird kind of jump. And pretty much when you level up on hard, or yeah, I think it's hard, and you get really good gear, you can pump it up a notch while leveling, but it's not really that necessary. And when you hit 70, you want to get to Torment 1 as fast as possible, so you skip everything. Because there's really no increased legendary drop rate between normal and the difficulty before Torment 1. There's no,
Master.
there is none. There is just experience and gold, I think. And from Torment 1, you kind of want to make the jump to T6 as fast as you can. So I agree with that said, is that you have to skip a lot, but where is the sweet spot? With the new greater rifting system where they remove trials, it's very easy for somebody to see what level they should do greater rifts, because it's indicated now. There's this little scroll menu, and level 25 is Torment 6, and so on and so forth. But for when you're leveling, it's not really clear where to go. So I get a lot of questions, like, I'm farming on Torment 3, and I really want to tell this guy to go back to Torment 1. Because that's probably more
More
efficient,
efficient,
but
but
that
that
doesn't
doesn't
make
make
sense
sense
for
for
him,
him,
maybe, because
because
for
for
him
him
it's
it's
like,
like,
yeah,
yeah,
but
but
I
I
can
can
survive
survive
Torment
Torment
3.
3.
He's like, yeah, but how long does it take you to kill a blue pack? Well, I died 2 to 3 times.
Well, yeah, I get
Yeah,
it.
but then you're better off going to Torment 1. But he says, yes, but Torment 3 gives me higher loot. But yeah, you see where my problem is?
Oh, definitely,
And that with the increase to Torment 10 is even bigger, because people are going to do T8 and T9 and T10 as fast as they can,
Oh
while
yeah.
just like spending maybe a well 5 minutes on an elite pack.
Yeah.
While they could just one shot that on Torment 6, perhaps, and get more loot.
Mm-hmm.
So we try, me and Deadset, I'm sure we try to make, those starting guides.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Just to explain.
I was
going to
say that. Yeah, you guys should definitely work on something, because the experience part is pretty interesting. I honestly don't know how much the initial, normal to hard to lay experience jump is. It's going to be pretty helpful. Yeah, guys.
Yeah. But that's, I guess, the kind of information that we have as more experienced players. And
Definitely.
We try to get the most efficient way of playing the playstyle.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what people are interested in, too.
Definitely, yeah. Definitely, there's obviously the numbers speak for themselves. You guys are doing great, and partly is because you are giving them something they don't know. It's mm-hmm. really good. So
yeah, so it's really nice to get those starter guides out there with this trick. When you are level one, you can get the weapon from your Templar for most efficiency. That's kind of the kind of stuff. To your point with the level difference, it's too much. I would rather see them. I think JH also made a post about this. Just keep it T6.
Mm-hmm.
Just make it more difficult on T6 instead of just adding a whole line of extra difficulties.
Yeah, definitely.
And making it even more confusing for the new player.
Mm-hmm. It's mathematically simple, right? I mean, from Torment 1 to Torment 6, you have 6 jumps to make, or 5 jumps, or whatever. But if you're adding a Torment 10 now, there's too many ladders to climb. And you don't know which one you want to stand on and which one's going to shake and break. And
I fully agree that there has to be a difficulty harder than Torment 6 before, Torment 6 is pretty much, especially with ancient items.
Yeah, it's just
a complete and utter joke.
Yeah.
Yeah, it feels like normal. So I'm completely for raising the difficulty, but maybe just, like Death said, just, make it a little bit more compact.
All right. So more of a trick question then for you, Deadset Man, is again, you are the master of builds for classes. You make so many guides. Now, I agree with you with Torment 6 being a difficulty which is easily achieved. But my argument is it's always achieved with a certain class. I mean, with a certain build and certain items equipped, right? You can't clear Torment 6 by having a random skill of your choosing. I mean, you don't have that free to put this skill in and, use this skill. So any thoughts on that, do you think? That Torment 6, yes, it's very accessible. Or let's call it Torment 10 for the upcoming patch. We will talk about the next patch, by the way. But the point is the second tier of difficulty, which is, I'm going to farm all of my sets now and I'm going to try and gear up for the end game, which is Greater Rift. That little stage over there. What do you think about the builds existing in that little niche section? Because that's where majority of the people would be playing. I mean, people would attempt Greater Rifts. Guys like me as well, right? I'll be exact. I think I'm Paragon 580 or something, which is, again, nothing compared to these guys. But when I will log in every once an hour a day or something, I would probably do some T6 quick runs, if I've only got 20 minutes, if I got an hour. That's what I'll be jumping at. And I think most of the public will play that, and you can check that quite simply by going to a public game and you can filter it out and see how many people are playing in what part of the game. And it gives an indication. And the point I'm trying to make there is, do you think like the builds, to me, they don't really seem that you still at Torment 6, the difficulty, I think, is not hard, but it's hard in a way that you're not free to do whatever you want. A place where you should be farming, where you should be, working towards the next goal, you're not really free there. So from at the Torment 1, at the early spot, at the hard difficulty, at the expert difficulty, you are a free man who can wander anywhere in Sanctuary, have a chat with Deckard Cain if he's still alive, I don't know where he is, and do whatever, go in the Khazra den and stalk that weird looking lady, and you can still do good, you can do good things. But at Torment 6, that amazing freedom, you're kind of being shackled there. So what are your thoughts on that, Deadset? What do you think about builds in general for Torment 6?
I guess by definition they have to do it like that. it's a mathematical problem that has no... It doesn't solve itself. It's endlessly scaling, especially with Greater Rifts. So something has to push the natural limits of those skills. And in this game, it's solved by items and set bonuses, right?
Mm-hmm,
so...
Definitely.
I see your point about the freedom. It's just, I guess it's just that at those difficulties, you're not hitting the upper ends of that math issue because, they're just at a lower number. The numbers are lower is what I mean.
Definitely.
So I guess the way they solve the issue by basically producing more and more sets targeted at certain underused skills. I think it's pretty clear that this is the way they address, they being Blizzard, they address the underplayed skills issue in the game and trying to make more things viable. That's the way they've chosen to do it. And I don't necessarily disagree, because if, I guess, if a set was too broad in a way, mm-hmm. if it encompassed, let's say, any spender that you can have as a monk or as a crusader or whichever class, you end up having on the concept, the crusader set, which buffs all the skills, and because of that, it feels bland. It's a bit of a, if the bonus encompasses all the skills, there's no way to make it feel flavorful, is what I want to say.
Okay.
It doesn't twist the skill in a particular way. It doesn't force you to think in a particular way, because it has to kind of encompass all of them. So, all
right.
I think, yeah, specialized sets and items are not necessarily bad, though they do make you feel like you're playing flavor of the month. But that's another issue.
Yeah,
I think
it's more of the
balance of the sets themselves, mm-hmm. rather than a problem of the design necessarily.
Okay. So Natsuma, like, moving on, basically adding on to this question, I'd like to get your opinion. And same thing, right? Deadset's making a great point, and that is, you know, you can't make a generic set that's going to buff a certain all the skills to a certain point. And that is, yeah, you can do Torment 6, you can do Greater of 30, but then if you want to do Greater of 40 or something, you know, that set kind of becomes underwhelming. So, you know, it's really a maths problem, and I really like the way you put it. I mean, it honestly is. Diablo is a game which is always has been about maths. I mean, if you go back to Auction House, that was a maths problem, and now critting for a certain number is also a maths problem, and clearing levels and everything you talked about, Natsuma, also is in some ways a maths problem, but a really good-looking, fun maths problem that you want to do,
yes,
unlike the one
you
get given at school. You know, it's about efficiency. It's a game that pushes a player's, you know, ideas and understanding about it. It's very easy to grasp, but when you want to master it, yes, you have to be a little bit more technical about it if you don't want to use the word mathematical, and that's how it is. But do you think there's a solution to this? Like, you know, yeah, we can't get sets that can, you know, buff all the skills. Do you think, is there any other way to make Torment 6 or like the second tier of difficulty, you know, slightly more varied in terms of playstyle? Or do you think we are okay right now where we sit?
Well, first of all, I think build diversity in most games is a myth.
Mm-hmm.
It's something that people wish for, but isn't exactly realistic. It doesn't matter what game you play, Diablo 3 or be it World of Warcraft, there's always going to be this one skill or this one set that will produce a slightly higher number of damage output,
mm-hmm.
that people will use. That's just how it is.
Right, yeah,
and it would, I think, you'd have to do immense research, mathematical calculations,
mm-hmm.
to make two sets so close to each other that they can compete. There's a lot of resources.
Yeah.
But I think a smart way that Blizzard is handling it right now in the seasons is per seasons to nerf or buff a certain set, or nerf a certain set and then buff another one. So
okay.
per season, they are kind of so-called forcing you to play a different build. For instance, in Season 1, we had the Carpal Tunnel Monk build, for instance, where you had to press three buttons as fast as you could for a maximum damage output. And then in Season 2, they remade that set, the Sunwoku,
mm-hmm. yeah.
The bell spam, and to interact with exploding palm and bells.
Mm-hmm.
And then in Season 3, they buffed the Raymond set, which was absolutely garbage.
Yeah.
And they made it better than the SWK set, so build diversity. And then in Season 4,
mm-hmm.
they are introducing a whole new set that uses seven-sided strike. So I think that's a way for Blizzard that they're handling build diversity, which I think is okay. I mean,
mm-hmm.
I'm fine. I think it would be weird if they introduced a set and the old one would still be better.
Oh, yeah, that's like nothing worse of a crime than, you know, the old thing being...
Yeah, exactly. So I think for greater rifting and maximizing efficiency,
mm-hmm.
Build diversity is a myth. Of course, there are some people argue that some variations of certain skills are better. That's pretty much the build variation, where one picks A regenerator and the other person picks B. But I think the place actually for build diversity is T6, because T6, not certainly T10, because T10 is kind of difficult, but if you look at Torment 6 with somebody that, for instance, has 500 Paragon, like you, has a couple of ancient items, should breeze through that difficulty. It's not hard. You might die to a molten explosion every now and then. I do too, there's no problem. But it isn't difficult content. So if you want to play with that skill that you want to, you could still do that on Torment 6 and get some sort of good kind of clear speed, but not, of course, the most efficient way of playing. I would never play a less efficient build. But some people would like, I really like, I don't know, Lashing Tailkick, Exploding Palm. That's still possible. While currently, Raiment of the Thousand Storm, Dashing Strike will pretty much beat out pretty much everything when you equip an Ingyom, which makes you have no cooldowns after you kill an elite pack. But somebody could still pick up that SWK set together with an Exploding Palm, equipping Kundos, and Lashing Tailkick or whatever. That's still possible if you want to.
Yeah, I'm the culprit. I was playing Great Area 43 and I was so proud of myself. So yeah,
it's possible, but it's just not the best it can be.
Definitely.
So there is some sort of build diversity for the Torment 6 variants, but for Greater Rifting, I would not say there's any build diversity. There is going to be a cookie cutter build. It's going to be developed over time.
Yes.
Yeah. But if you really want to have fun and kind of tinker with your own build, just go down a difficulty and just have fun there. But there is build diversity in higher level play is just not there. The only thing that we can be grateful for is that Blizzard does something different every season to make you play different builds. That's my take.
Any thoughts, Deadset? Anything you would like to add on this? What do you think about higher difficulties and greater rifts?
Yes, I hate him for arguing that this is the way things should be. No.
It's not necessarily the way it should be, but the way it works now.
I'll find you and drag you by the ears.
I'm really curious.
Know where you live.
That's it. So what's the dream here? I would like, so this is reality Natsuma gave you, and you know, Mr. That's it's going to give us a dream, which is what I'm actually excited for, honestly. So let's hear it, man. What do you think of the whole
situation? Well, I think he argued in favor of flavor of the month builds, which irks me. This is not the way it should be. I think I argued about it in the State of Sanctuary with pretty much, I'm going to say pretty much the same thing. But really what I would argue about is that build diversity in a game is measured by not the fact that a new build is introduced and overrides the old ones, but that a new build is introduced and added alongside the old ones. And I don't think that we should necessarily stick to a level of power every single season. We could, of course, increase that, have a power creep situation where we are able to reach higher and higher. And we already have that, for sure. But I do take certain issue with new playstyles overriding the old ones completely.
But that is what is currently happening.
Yes,
that's
but it's
what's
not
happening.
Good.
No, I didn't necessarily argue that it's good, but that's the only build diversity we're getting.
I guess, but I think what they can do and what I think they are doing, because at least the way I see it, the sets introduced in patch 2.3, the upcoming patch, are closer to the sets in 2.2 than the sets introduced in 2.2 to the ones from 2.1, if that makes sense.
Okay.
The disparity is much less, you know, pronounced. And this is good, because the way I would balance it if I was in charge of balancing things was I would pick a baseline, an imaginary baseline of greater rifting, because the greater rifting is currently the measuring stick. It's not the torments, but rather the GRs. So I would pick a level where the impact of the rift itself and its kind of composition, the monsters, layouts, and pylon placement, their impact is as close to zero as possible. So whether that would be greater rift 55 or 60, depending on how much of a power creep there is, but I'll pick that baseline where the rift is still irrelevant about the clear, of a successful clear, I mean.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be my balancing and measuring stick, my imaginary GR that I think should be completed as a developer in this season. And then just slightly increase it, I guess, over time to give the feeling of progression and character advancement. But
yeah, that's such a great point, man. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think this is the way to really do it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they're doing something like that. Yeah, I think they're picking like a 55 or 60 as a baseline,
mm-hmm.
and they're trying to bump up the sets and playstyles across the board to reach up that kind of a baseline.
Yeah, because
past
from season 1 to 4, we've been going higher and higher.
Yeah, past a certain point, of course, the rift is going to become a huge factor, huge percentage of your potential clear or failure.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the monsters, the pylons, all the other random elements kick in that don't depend necessarily on you. And certain builds are better at dealing with those than others.
Yeah.
But up until a certain point, I think there is still the opportunity to balance around and kind of bump up old play styles.
That's such a great point. Like, I don't know, Natsuma, sorry, I should be impartial, but I don't know, I'm so... This point resonates with me so much. I agree. And it's not that you're saying the opposite way, but I guess like to add a third view on it, I agree so much that, yeah, like a top player like Natsuma, it's a simple answer that if you want to do something, if you want to be the best at something, then there has to be one way of doing it. Because if there were two ways of doing it, there'll be two best people in the world, you know. You can't have that, you know. If you want to be the best, you'll have to have one way, which makes sense, right? Which is good. I mean, you have one way of playing it. But if you want to be the average Joe or the semi-average Joe who wants to farm and wants to, you know, still do good, as like, you know, an example here, greater of 55 to greater of 45 or to greater of 50, that little difference, that's where other builds should still exist, and they should still be good enough where, okay, maybe I didn't find the ancient item for the ideal, you know, Natsuma build that I have right now. Maybe I've just got, you know, the Inner set right now. I can make this set work until greater of 45 or 50, and that's good enough for me until I find the next one. But I think right now that the point would be that if there is one build that's in the flavor of the month, as we talked about, right? Then if you don't have the ingredients for that flavor of the month, your soup's just going to taste bad. You know, you have to...
Yeah.
The jump is so significant. I mean, we always talk about how T1 to T6 jump is huge. But I think the bigger jump is getting, you know, this doing greater if 40 or greater if, you know, whatever, to doing like a 50 greater ifs and, you know, all these things. Because as we all know, you know, it's not like a linear increase from 41 to 42, 43. I mean, the monster, the XP, the toughness level, it's more of an exponential or instead, you know, of a curve, you know, it's not easy. And these things are tough. So I think that's the place where we might still have room for build diversity and just keep the old builds alive, you know. That'll be something good that could be.
The dream would honestly to have build diversity. Like, I'm not arguing that I like there's only one build.
Uh-huh.
You're just part of Dashing Strike.
And this is the point of me saying it, that there is always, through math, going to be a better build.
I agree 100%, yeah.
But that's not something that I personally like.
Mm-hmm.
I would rather have three builds competing for the top one. That'd
mm-hmm.
be amazing, because then you could, like, some people would say, I really don't like playing the Dashing Strike build.
Yeah.
But there is, if I want to compete, I need to play it.
Yeah.
And
yep.
Currently, like that set said, the difference is becoming smaller because the Dashing Strike set
mm-hmm.
is very close to the new seven-sided strike set.
Oh, okay.
But not close enough to compete.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's how it will always, well, always, unless there's like a ton of investment into those calculations, like that said. So putting that baseline and just like getting it as close as possible, but to make them exactly the same,
mm-hmm.
That's a challenge I would like to honestly give Blizzard. Like, please show me that's possible. That would be amazing, because it's not nice that somebody has to play a build they don't like in order to compete.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, currently, that's the harsh truth.
That's a great point. Okay. So I guess moving on, guys. So what we basically discussed here, I mean, the whole gist of it was that the difficulty jumps are kind of steep and the builds, sometimes they can't keep up. There's one big champion who's, you know, in a 1,000-meter race or 800-meter race, he's at the finish line and the other guy's halfway through and the other one hasn't even started, you know. And this little gap, it's coming, this big gap is kind of becoming little and little to a point where at some point in the near future, we might see, you know, it all being closed up. And don't get us wrong, right? I speak for everyone here that we love the way the game is moving forward. That the game, the Reaper of Souls that launched on day one to where we are right now, you know, it's the game has been getting better and better, and you know, the things have been good. But we're just talking about, you know, the future of how things could improve. I think that's our job to do, you know, to stimulate and to start a conversation. And a discussion where we talk about these things. So the power curve, the power difference, I think another big culprit or the winner, whichever way you want to look at it, or like the whole big supplement to this whole thing, is the addition of ancient items, right? Mm-hmm. Some people loved it, some people hated it. Now, I spoke to Mr. Ziggy a while ago. We recorded a podcast a while ago, and he made this point back then that, I don't know, I'm not so sure about ancient items. They're great, don't get me wrong. Recently, I found an incense torch to the Grand Temple that was ancient. I mean, I jumped off my seat. Yeah. Don't get me wrong. I loved it. But I hated that Diablo until I found it. And it took me whatever many months. So the point I'm making is, are these ancient items. Do you think that's a good way to solve the power curve, the power gap? I mean, the way they're advertised, I mean, I'm sure we all have heard of this, is Blizzard says that these are items that only the prowess of the pro players go for, you know? It's to give you, quote-unquote, a little edge, you know? That's what they say. It'll give you a little edge to get to the next level.
Yeah, not really.
But I'm afraid to say that it's not really little. I think it's a big, 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 big factor. If you don't have an ancient weapon, I guess don't even try a greater rift to, you know, to like in a competitive way. You're not going to be able to get there. And if you don't have all the items ancient, you can't strive for the top of the leaderboard. Mm-hmm. That's at least my silly opinion. Yeah. So guys, open question again to both of you. Add on to that. What do you think of the ancient items in the game now?
I think it's quite discouraging or just a completely terrible feeling to find an item in Diablo 3. Because I find a flying dragon, I'm just looking at the stats and it's beautiful. It has the highest damage roll. It has the best dex roll. Maybe I want vitality on it and life on hit, and it's just perfect. Mm-hmm. But it's not ancient, so I salvage it.
Yeah.
You know, it happened multiple times that I just found that item I was looking for, but it did not have the golden border. So it went to the blacksmith and he did whatever he wanted to do with it. Mm-hmm. That's something that I think really kind of takes away the fun of finding an item that you need, but because it doesn't have the golden border, I don't even look at it anymore.
Okay.
And some people, the thing is that the ancient items for the pro people, well, then they should make it a grind instead of a luck factor. Because I've seen people with, I don't know, 300 to 400 less hours to me with better gear than I do. Mm-hmm. And that's Diablo 3.
Yeah, that's RNG.
but the ancient edition is, in Season 2, for instance, like you said, with the ancient torch. I knew tons of people that invested thousands of hours and they were not able to compete because they didn't find an ancient item.
There we go, yeah.
And that is just another layer of RNG. And that's like what Blizzard says, it's an additional farming method, yes. But there's a chance that you, I don't know. It's very conflicting. At one point, I really like finding an ancient item because that's just cool. But if you don't find it, then you cannot compete.
I agree. What about you, Deadset? What are your thoughts on ancient items? Had any good luck? Have you been getting good items? Or do you think it's like a silly idea to have them? Your thoughts, my friend.
When I first heard about ancient items, I guess I was mostly bored with what they were.
They're pretty much the level 37, right? Yeah. Or 63, sorry, 63 rare items.
70.
Yeah.
I know. Yeah, I honestly would say I don't mind their existence. I understand Natsuma's concerns from a slightly more competitive perspective, or maybe kind of a lot more competitive perspective, but anyway. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think I was mostly bored with their existence and the reason why they were added, because they're just extensions of the farming time, really, to me. They're slowing down or adding more to the gear progression to make up for the fact that it had gotten too fast at the time of their adding, which was after the initial increase to drop rates at the anniversary events, which basically doubled the legendary drop rate or something, in 2005. 14th, I think, anniversary event just stayed permanent. Then
yes.
kind of the functionality to gamble for sets was added, which was not present at release. I think the loot progression just got too fast at the time. Legendary gems started existing. This was a huge power spike and significantly sped up farming times and the opportunity of people to carry in the highest torment difficulties for people to gear up. So this is just another bump in the road, the way I see it. And I don't, again, I really don't mind its existence, even more so now that they're adding more ways to actually obtain and target items like that.
Yeah, we're
going to
go to that point.
But I was never excited by their existence, which is unfortunate, I think. Whenever there is a new addition to a game which you're not excited about, it's like, why are they adding it in the first place?
Yeah.
But it's, if you pardon the pun, the ancient topic is ancient history at this point in the game, isn't it?
Yeah.
I guess I've gotten used to their existence.
Okay.
At first, I was really opposed to them because of how boring they were.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, I really just see them as another bump in the road.
Oh, fair enough.
Yeah.
So to add on to that,
farming.
Add on to that question, guys, little side topic here. When the most our beloved expansion comes out, and I'm rooting for a character which is something like a Native American, amazing, you know, guy, who's a shapeshifter who can turn into, I don't know, a jaguar or something. Come on, guys, patent pending. You know, I'm gonna get the money. They have that character. But the point is, when the expansion comes in, the class, the character level cap would go higher, I think. I'm just assuming. But the point is, the items are gonna get stronger. Like from Reaper of Souls, earlier before that, you had level 16, now level 70 is the cap. You know, maybe level 80 would come. So do you think that the future of Diablo, are we gonna keep getting ancient versions of items, or are they gonna stop at one point? Like, any quick thoughts on this one? Do you think that this is something that will continue to exist, or? Because when something new comes by, everyone hits the reset switch, right? Like,
mm-hmm.
all the problems that, you know, Deadset amazingly explained, very nicely, actually. I didn't even think of it that way, how the community buff came and it was added and people find more legendaries and gems or, you know, all this thing. When you get the next expansion, and ideally, I think you're going to get, you know, level 80. And another little speculation from mine would be a side note is Barbarian can dual wields. Come on, that'll be level 80.
Oh, that would be lovely.
Yeah, but...
Oh, God.
That's just like, oh, that's going to be a nightmare.
Be a pretty, pretty big counter thing to that, but yeah.
Uh-huh. But so, like, do you think when the level cap increases, all the items we have right now would be kind of, you know, useless in some
all
most of the
would
ways?
Be.
So do you think...
Sure.
Yeah, do you think ancient items would still exist? Or, you know, it's more of the same question, really. Like, would you like them to exist? Or is it something that, you know, they're just going to remove in the next... you know, next expansion or the next moving on forward from, you know, where we are right now. Any thoughts on that, guys?
I don't think they're going to remove ancient items.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you find a level 70 ancient Daibo, Flying Dragon, for instance, I keep going to this Flying D.
Mm-hmm.
when you hit levels 80, you're going to find an 80 version Flying Dragon
mm-hmm.
ancient.
Yeah.
What I do think is a problem is the stats on it. You're already pushing Greater Rift 70 plus.
Mm-hmm.
Where's that going to stop when you go to level 80? Are we going to be pushing 99s? Is it going to be over 100?
I think so, yeah. Yeah,
yeah, maybe. Or are we going to see a stat squish like what happened in World of Warcraft or Lords of Draenor? Are we going to go back to a little bit less damage
uh-huh.
to kind of reset that? Because there are some server issues with too
yeah.
many numbers.
Uh-huh.
Quite
okay.
a couple of issues that
actually,
your game freezes
uh-huh.
and you cannot complete the Greater Rift. That's going to be an even bigger issue with more numbers. So I do think ancient items will just stay in the game unless they are going to say, well, you know, ancient items were a nice experiment. We're going to remove them. We're going to add something new.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm pretty sure Diablo is just about getting more powerful and hitting that next. Yeah,
definitely. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so I guess moving on to one of the final topics, if you will. We have still have a couple of topics. I hope you're enjoying this, guys, by the way, because I'm really having a blast with these guys. And
oh, I'm having a great time. Yeah,
yeah, so Dead says, like, I hate you guys. but the point is, I think, is PTR.
I was thinking of how to put it nicely.
No.
I'm kidding.
You're too nice. We're just being harsh on you. So PTR, guys, I know both of you have tried so many amazing things there. A couple of new things are being added. couple of amazing things are being added, to be honest. So you played them, you play, you've seen all the new sets, you've seen a special thing called Kanai's Cube, which I think everyone now knows about. Even if you don't play Diablo, you must have, you know, heard it from someone or somewhere in the forum post. One of the coolest additions, I think, by far in the recent memory. All of this, what do you think about it, guys? What's your take on PTR right now? Let's start off with sets, for example. So each class is getting set, and I'm going to start with the Deadset now, because Crusader, you know, I want to know his opinions of how things are going to be. I mean, any thoughts on that, like how items are being reworked, and you're getting season-only legendaries and all these amazing things you're testing in PTR. Are you excited for the next patch?
For the Hammerdin, yeah, for sure. I mean, Hammers has long been perceived as the beginner skill, kind of the thing that you take when you have nothing. Mm-hmm. So to now see it from the perspective of an endgame build is refreshing. And on top of that, that's the Hammerdin nostalgia. So
yeah, it's even better as well.
In a way.
Great.
There's still some kinks to iron out, I think. Mm-hmm. I'm still really not convinced that Falling Sword will be hugely impactful to the build. It's helpful, but I'm not sure if it's necessary. But either way, it has been improved as well, so it's kind of part of the playstyle right now. I don't think it's actually going to be ditched from the build. Okay. Either way, though, I really think it's a cohesive playstyle, which is good. It's mm-hmm. simple, straightforward. I would still fix a few things. For example, why the heck does provoke not proc focus and restraint? Makes mm-hmm. no sense to me, since they've added the functionality to ground stomp for barbs to actually proc focus and restrain. Mm-hmm. And it's basically the same thing.
Lizard, please.
Yeah, please. Seriously. but yeah, or certain skills and runes not actually getting the set bonus. But either way, I'm sure these are things that will get addressed in time as the PTR develops. So doesn't really make sense to talk about the bugs right now, rather than the set itself, which is pretty damn good. But it does depend on how much you enjoy kiting builds. If you don't enjoy kiting, if you don't enjoy kind of a stutter-stepping playstyle, this might not be the set for you.
Okay.
And so, as always, it's a notch above the old ones and the old playstyles. So, once again,
yeah, we'll
the
have
new
to
one overwatching the old ones. But to a lesser extent, it's actually Roland is still pretty competitive. Akan is just primed for rework.
Even with the crowd control nerf? Even with the crowd control nerf, as Roland still using it?
You could just go for something else. I mean, the damage has been reduced. You could go for... I guess the great part about the old one was how much control it exhibited over monsters and such. Mm-hmm. So you could permastun. But now it's no longer all that necessary to permastun. So, you could just go for more damage and stuff.
Oh, great. So overall, you're satisfied with what you're getting in the upcoming patch?
Is sure. Safe to say? With the small caveat that you have to enjoy kind of a mid-range playstyle. Mm-hmm. If you want to be up close and personal, this is not the set for that.
Okay, good. We are going to get back to that topic later on to just talk about, you know, to wrap things up. But let's hear from Natsuma. My friend, we're getting a really cool set. People have been speculating about Seven-Sided Strike. Like, from the first moment I personally saw the Monk trailer video, when, you know, Monk was premiered, they showed, I think, Stinging Winds or something, Act 2 area, where the way Seven-Sided Strike operated was a completely different way. And then when we played the game, this skill has never been viable, right? Since the beginning, this skill has never done anything good up until now. So what are your thoughts on Monks in general? We're also getting a buff to Shenlongs, I believe. I can personally attest to that. So how are things looking for Monk now?
Okay, I'll start with the Shenlongs and I'll go to Julianas, because I actually have quite a lot to say about Julianas as of now.
Please, yeah, let's hear it. Let's hear it all.
Well, the Shenlongs' fists were extremely overpowered when they were introduced. I think for people that know what Shenlongs, how they got changed, it's pretty much the old version increased your damage per spirit you have by 1%. And it also, when you cap on spirit, you get 300, it's the old one again, 300% damage. But your spirit would slowly diminish, and you could only regenerate your spirit through a regenerator. I think their original intention was to actually let the spirit drain, so you would not have a permanent 300% damage buff. But of course, we broke it, and we, like any good Diablo 3 player would do, and we managed to managed to get a 300% uptime permanently, albeit through a regenerator build or the dashing strike. So we soon jumped to those 70, 75, 78 greater rifts. So that was you know, quickly attended to in the next patch, and now they actually made it. You know, they nerfed it, kind of, without making it bad. Usually, when something gets nerfed, it often gets nerfed and put into the shelf for your stash and, you know, on your mule, and it collects dust for whenever it will get a buff again.
Okay.
What they did now is they reduced the 300% to 100 while increasing the damage you get per spirit. It went from 1% to 2.
Okay.
Which makes it pretty decent now, and albeit not as powerful as the Yuliana set, it will still be, I think, the way to go for non-season, because there's, of course, a big build difference between non-seasonal monks and seasonal monks, because there's often key items being withheld from non-seasonal.
Monks especially get it the hardest every single time.
Yeah, Gundo gear, the bracers, spirit guards, and now it's the lion's claw. So that's pretty much my take on Shenlongs.
So
I like Shenlongs
let's
right
talk
now.
Numbers. Sorry to intervene. And
no,
I'm
no
also
problem.
Going to get a number from Deadset. So what number, a greater rift number, can a guy comfortably do with the Shenlong set? I'm curious personally, to be honest. In PTR, have you attempted like any higher greater rift?
Me?
After the nerf, I mean? After the
100%? Yeah, it's really difficult to assess who done the most because there are currently people with 4,000 Paragon on PTR, but that's a whole different topic.
Okay.
I think the highest on non-season is a 68.
Okay.
Legit.
Oh, wow.
Which is, of course, higher pushable, so 70. For non-season, for season, legit, the same amount, because the non-seasonal items and the seasonal items are the same. But for current testing, non-seasonal has higher Paragon overall than seasonal on PTR, because you have to re-level.
Okay.
So I think that will hit around 70. And Yuliana's will probably go higher than that because there's a pretty low Paragon guy with average gear hitting 70 with Yuliana's currently.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I'll get back to Yuliana, but I want to know Deadset's opinion. So Deadset, did you get to try the new Hamadan set? What number can you push as a Crusader? Like, as a guy who doesn't know much about Hamadan, if I pick up Crusader, what numbers can we push there? What are we looking like? Roughly, level are we looking at?
With Hamardin right now, and it still has not been reached, I find it hard to believe it will pass 67.
Oh, okay.
That's not
it's
bad.
Lower, for sure. Mm-hmm.
And any alternate items that you're getting, season-only items in the next patch that might help with the existing sets? Anything that's gonna, like, you know, buff up the numbers for any other sets? So what I'm asking is, like, what's the highest level of Greater Rift a Crusader can do? Roughly, of course, you know, give and take plus 3 or 4. You know, greater rift levels. Any ideas on that?
Unless I'm missing something crucial, I'm just seeing kind of a ceiling at 68. But
okay.
Mm.
All right, that's pretty good.
The seasonal item is interesting. I would not call it necessary, which is good. I think that's the right approach to seasonal items. Kind of adding more utility on top of Falling Sword without necessarily being the only way to go for the belt slot.
Okay.
But yeah, that's actually the only seasonal item for Crusaders specifically, so everything else is available to non-season as well, the set included, of course.
Nice. So 68 is a pretty good number then. I think Crusaders will be happy next patch then.
Caveat being that I still have not seen it accomplished. I still don't think anyone has farmed the right items to do that kind of a level. I think 65 has been reached so far and nothing higher, but I don't think they're actually playing the right build.
Yeah. I mean, it's only PTR, right? You know, they need guys like you, in all honesty, you know, two short builds. And okay, that's good. 68 sounds good. Natsuma, going back to the Seven-Sided Strike set. So what's amazing? Explain that set to us quickly. So what does that set do? Because it sounds amazing.
Yeah. It's currently a little bit too amazing. The two set bonus applies Exploding Palm on your third hit on your regenerator, which is, in Greater Rifts, for the build, useless. Because we use an item called Madstone, which applies Exploding Palm with your 7-sided strike.
Do you cube that Madstone? Oh,
yeah,
we'll go to
cube
later.
Yeah, you cube it.
Okay, cool. And, yeah,
and there's currently a bug that when you apply your Exploding Palm with the two-piece bonus from Juliana, you don't get any bonus additive damage. Ooh. But I hope that's going to be fixed.
Yeah,
because that's, of course, ridiculous.
Okay. What's the second bonus then?
No, I'm just thinking about the about how that works. But let's hope they fix it. The four set bonus is that your seven sided strike hit.
Mm-hmm.
Does the total damage of seven sided strike. So while now it's roughly, I think, 9,000% weapon damage over 7 seconds.
Yeah, 3K for the teleporting one.
Yeah,
wow.
Exactly. That's... And now it's around 9K or whatever number per hit.
That's ridiculous, man.
That's,
like from 10K dashing strike to 9K.
Okay. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
And the six piece is that your seven-sided strike explodes your exploding palm or detonates your exploding palm, which means that the exploding palm can actually be used on single target. Because usually, when in season two, when you played bell build, if you had a boss that did not spawn any ads or whatever, exploding palm
escape
would be useless.
Game.
Mm-hmm. Sorry,
escape leave game. No, wasn't that
exactly.
Pretty much.
That would be bad. The current problem. Which I guess I'm just going to from this point with seven-sided strike. It's too good, but also it's terrible. It's kind of weird. Seven-sided strike is a very old skill.
Yeah.
It hasn't been looked at the runes. Currently, there's only one viable rune by miles.
Okay.
It's not like they're the percentage cold or percentage fire because I want to use it with my regenerator. Mm-hmm. No, there is one skill that more than halves the cooldown.
Yeah, sustain.
Seven sided strike.
Yeah.
With enough cooldown reduction on your gear gives you near invulnerability.
Yeah.
And that's an issue.
Mm-hmm.
If we go back to season two, Serenity, Perma Immunity, that was nerfed.
Yeah.
That was nerfed.
New
ballot, yeah. It was after season two, it was nerfed.
Yeah.
The nerf was that if you use Serenity, after the duration of Serenity, your cooldown would start. So it would make it impossible to get 100% upkeep. Yeah, that's not the case with seven-sided strike. There is a sort of second to half a second downtime on your seven-sided strike.
Mm-hmm.
But if you position yourself good enough with like maybe a quick dash or a potion press, you're going to be fine. And that's an issue because now we're going back to reaching that perma invulnerability.
While stealing a ridiculous amount of damage. I mean, this
while
is not
dealing
a
ridiculous monster. Amount of damage.
Yeah.
Yes.
So.
Yes, because there's an interesting thing. I don't know if you're familiar with the ring Broken Promises.
Uh-huh, yeah.
For viewers that don't know what the ring, what it means is that after 5 non-crits in a row,
you
have 100% chance to crit. Well, that ring is kind of garbage for everything else, but for seven-sided strike, it works miracles.
It's
pretty much, it's close to 100% uptime. Well, close to, it has a really high uptime.
Yeah.
Which means that you can just take crit away from your gear.
Which
and
is such
add cooldown reduction.
Thing. Mm-hmm.
For no, you don't, your damage doesn't reduce at all.
Yeah,
because
no trade-off.
There's no trade-off. But if you were not to use Broken Promises, you would have to exchange your dexterity for cooldown reduction, which is a damage loss, especially in an ancient ring. That's a lot.
That's
a, but now you can stack vitality in your gloves instead of crit. You can go cooldown reduction instead of crit. So you have a dexterity, cooldown reduction, critical damage strike ring. It's
talk
crazy.
About vanilla items, you know?
Yeah, and that's combined with permanent, like pretty much permanent invulnerability.
Yeah, man, yeah.
Is not a good place.
Mm-hmm.
Which is most of the reason why we're currently using 3 monks and a support barbarian in 4-man Great Rift. Because monks are just able to survive anything because we just don't get damage.
Yeah. That definitely
and that's an issue.
Like a problem, yeah.
That's a big, big issue that I hope maybe tomorrow. I'm not sure if tomorrow's the new patch. It's kind of a 2-week interval usually with patches on the PTR. Maybe it will be addressed. Maybe they have no clue.
Is it Wednesday or patch day, I think? Yeah.
Wednesday? Oh, well, we'll see. Whatever
yeah,
comes
hopefully,
up.
I agree.
Let's hope soon. Hopefully soon. Oh, no. Yeah, Wednesday patched.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully soon, but I don't really think they want this again. Mm-hmm. While it's not 100% invulnerability, it does allow us to do way higher greater rift than we're supposed to.
Okay. Yeah. No, that's... I agree with you there. I mean, that's... Yeah. That's too much of a broken mechanic going on.
It's the build is called Broken Palm.
Yeah.
So that's just an issue from my point of view. Some people might think, Natsuma, why do you care?
Mm-hmm.
It's because I think Blizzard just doesn't want that, and
it's
kind of unfair to other classes as well, because having three monks in a Great Rift party together with a barbarian isn't.
Yeah.
I don't think Blizzard wants that.
No, definitely not the way people were playing right now.
No, because we'll see 90% monks played in Season 4.
Okay, wow.
With that, because why would you play another class?
Mm-hmm. When you can do that much
damage. That much better. That's true.
Yeah.
Also, that ground stomp thing that barbs run that doesn't diminish, it's kind of weird, isn't
it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's fixable for sure. Yeah.
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 They have a pull move that doesn't actually get diminished by the crowd control changes. That's kind of weird.
Wrenching smash, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So that's just... I would see that as an issue. I think that would take the fun away for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, hope someone fixes that. That's really a good point you guys are bringing. These are fair things. I'm pretty sure no one's going to disagree with that. That's something that needs to be fixed.
Yeah, but not the last day, the barbarian braces, please.
Mm-hmm.
We don't need that stuff again.
Okay, then. So, I think last topic would be, the last official topic would be, I think, Kanai's Cube, guys, really. So, I want to know what Deadset thinks about that item. I've tried it. It looks amazing. Ruins of Sesheron, by the way, guys, a side note, is such a great level. It's all what I expected from Diablo. We talked about how the game looked in the beginning to where Reaper of Souls looked dark and danky. Man, Ruins of Sesheron is up my alleyway. And if that's how the next expansion and the next content is going to be like, hats off to them. It's such a great level. You play that.
Yeah.
I'm not going to ruin it for anyone. Go play. The first thing you do when you get the whole thing, play that
I
level.
I love the
guys.
Yetis. I love the Yetis.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, killing Yetis. Who doesn't want to kill him, huh? So you go there, you delve in further, and an amazing guy who was a Blizzard employee who passed away last year, in his memory, they made this awesome item, which really is awesome, and I think Deadset's going to tell us all about it. So what is the Kanai's Cube, sir?
Well, the Kanai's Cube is supposedly a more ancient version, but kind of the heir to what we know as the Heraldic Cube in Diablo II, offering a generous amount of recipes, which are actually listed, so you don't have to dig them up from anywhere, with the exception of one or two bonus ones for hidden levels and such.
Oh yeah,
but we're not
going to talk about those.
Apart from that, it offers the unique opportunity to store an item's power in it. So you get the opportunity to steal the legendary power from a legendary weapon, a legendary armor piece, and a legendary jewelry piece. You cannot store set powers. That's a restriction. And
there'll be something.
Yeah, there would be something, wouldn't it?
Shenlong sets, man, everything. Every class will get that.
You cannot store powers from other classes, but you get the added bonus of stealing the item's power at its full value. So you can place a furnace at, let's say, 41%, which is absolute garbage, and you'll steal a 50% power, which actually might not be the right decision. I'm not sure. Wouldn't it add a little
aspect.
More? Yeah. Wouldn't it add a little more farming to the game if it steals the particular percentage?
Yeah, the exact number
of
your item you're holding.
Number.
I agree there. That's a good
kind
point,
of maybe.
It really doesn't make it any more difficult, because the item roll can be garbage. It can be non-ancient, but you still want to look for the ethics.
Yeah.
But Kanai's Cube, huh?
Yeah,
from the things
else.
That I did not expect from patch 2.3, I think this is at the top. I did not expect anything like this.
No.
To make an appearance.
Very creative.
Yeah, it's such a big thing, right? I mean, it solves all the problems, Nats, I think, of, we talked about the gap in builds and all that stuff. Now you have a slightly more breathing room, if you love something that much, An idiot like me, I just want to play with Lashing Tail Kick, man. I don't know. I can add Ganya Kashu. I don't know why I would add that. Probably because I'm an idiot. But, I can still add that and have fun.
Yeah.
And more importantly, you can add important powers like Nats talked about, where put a Madstone in your, armor piece and you can do amazing things with that.
Yeah.
So it changes the game in all the good ways. I don't think it's broken in any way. It's just as a Deadset pointed out, it would be good if you could, you know, extract the existing legendary stat, you know, legendary power out of it, you know, like yeah. gave an example of Furnace. So I think that's something good, but still what it offers us right now is pretty amazing, and I think it's for the good stuff. But what about rerolling? I think you can also reroll items again in that, right, Nat? How yeah. viable is that? I mean, if I have a flying dragon, I want to make it ancient. How viable is it? Is it completely far-fetched, you know?
Well, not really. I think there are items in the game that are extremely rare to get. Mm-hmm. Get your Star Metal Kukri,
yeah.
or your Furtas, or Fist of Asterask, or whatever item you find, you look up the table, it's like, oh, god damn, this item has a 2% chance of dropping. Mm-hmm. I just managed to obtain it, but it's garbage. And I really don't feel like doing more greater rifts to find a particular item. So yeah. Blizzard gave you an option to go farm bounties.
Mm-hmm.
Yay, bounties. like
I hear the sarcasm in your voice.
Yeah, it's another topic for another day, I guess. But
yeah.
If you really want an item and you found it once, like let's just say the furnace. Furnace is pretty much the item for most people, even though it might not be so good, but it's a very, everybody knows the furnace and how cool it is and how rare it is.
Mm-hmm.
And if you find one furnace and you thought, okay, I don't have, like for instance, as you say, I only have an hour a day to play
mm-hmm.
the game. And I don't have the time to farm greater rifts for the highest chance of getting a furnace because you just get more legendaries.
Yep.
Go do a bounty run. Go to, like, do two bounty runs throughout every act.
Yeah.
And reroll your item twice to yeah. potentially get it ancient instead of farming the game.
Mm-hmm.
That's an option.
Yeah.
That takes away part of the ancient problem, I guess, because you don't have to find the item as much. Because it's mm-hmm. it's if you get it once, you can just reroll it with the cube.
Yeah. No, instead I can definitely add on to that, mate. Thanks, by the way, to Deadset. The other day we were playing, right? I mean, I messaged him.
Oh,
again,
yeah, that's
and,
true.
And, you know, he's all of a sudden, he's got his barbarian in the game. He's like, oh, just give me a second. I'm going to leave the game. I'll join back. And he joins back with the Crusader and he logs out again and he brings back barbarian. Oh, by the way, would you like to have this? And there on my screen was an ancient furnace with amazing stats. And I'm not joking, guys. I have, I don't know, 3K hours into the game at least. I think I have 2K hours into Monk alone since the beginning. Obviously, Furnace didn't come then. But the point is I've played the game a lot and I have never seen a furnace in my life. And this guy comes in and he just, you know, here you go, a free furnace. So
yep.
thanks,
yep,
man. That was awesome. Yep. You know, that's yep. that's amazing. So, but yeah, the great point you're making is, yeah, if you get the item you want, the super rare drop, Mara's Kaleidoscope or whatever, something
yeah.
that you've always wanted and you want an ancient version, you want it to go slightly higher, you know, the whole existence of ancient item, you want it to be ever so slightly more powerful, then Cube offers that thing too. So,
yeah.
you know, all in all, really good things. That item is going to be pretty, pretty
yeah.
good. So
it also has an effect on blood shards, because if you're not going to roll for weapons anymore with blood shards because it's highly inefficient.
Mm-hmm.
So if you get that one item, you're just going to go for armor pieces, pretty much. And you're going to farm bounties if you want to reroll your weapon, for instance.
Oh, yeah, definitely, yeah. You just want to get everything else ancient, which is easier to get. You know, the 75
yep.
cost is just too expensive, yep. or 100 or whatever. For
because getting a furnace from Kadal
no.
and it being ancient is quite painful.
Mm-hmm. I can imagine. So I think these are our main topics for today, guys. But we do have one special topic, I think, which is more of us being responsible members of the community. I think we've talked about everything that we love about the game. I think there's no two opinions about it, but I would like to bring up certain topics which less so than guys like me who don't play that much these days, but more so like guys like, you know, my awesome friends here who play, who experience a lot, and that's the issue of botting. Right now, I thought botting had stopped a while ago when, you know, the auction house went away and people had learned, you know, to be nice for a change, and that's not the case. So I think I'm gonna let Natsuma explain, because we were talking about this before the whole podcast, is what's going on, man. This whole botting thing, that kind of sounds a bit, you know, off to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does feel its impact the most out of any of us, I think.
Yeah, well, botting has been around, like you said, since vanilla,
mm-hmm.
and it never really stopped. But lately, it's been getting way more popular than it's ever been as a topic.
Okay.
A lot of people are getting aware of what this means. I think a big part of the the people that we as streamers or YouTube creators or YouTube content creators or just community members mm-hmm. are responsible for this, because we talk a lot about it. Uh-huh. Either because we think it's unfair or that the community should know. I'm for one somebody that would talk about this subject to just let more people know and mm-hmm. for people to keep an eye on, because just the botting aspect of Diablo 3 is, of course, when you are playing the game yourself, mm-hmm. you're being the most efficient. That's the truth. If I'm going to farm greater rifts, I'm going to farm greater rifts. And I'm not going to let a bot do that. I don't bot, by the way, just for, mm-hmm. you know, disclosure.
Oh, but for instance, stream. We know you don't, man. Yeah, carry on.
Yeah, but for instance, what I hate to do is farming bounties, getting those rift keys, because I just want to do greater rifts. So I, for instance, have to do bounties, get my rift keys, do those rifts to get greater rift keys, and then do trials to get higher greater rift keys, or just speed farming keys. With botting, that person can go to sleep, program the bot to do bounties, to get those rift keys, mm-hmm. get those rift keys into greater rift keys, and get greater rift farming keys. I still have to do that when I wake up the next yep. morning. Yeah. That person can just go and do whatever he wants to do, because he sleeps for 8 hours, lets his bot run, and gets everything he needs for the next morning.
Yeah.
I haven't even discussed the item advantage of running 8 hours of rifts while you're sleeping.
Yeah. Yeah, item XP, everything, man. You
items, experience, yeah. everything. It's mm-hmm. getting ancients, getting, for instance, that physical resistance, Ring of Royal Grandeur. Mm-hmm. You can just let your bot farm bounties for 8 hours straight, and then you wake up and you're like, oh, God, oh, it's there. Oh, wow, you know, I farmed so much. That's mm-hmm. that's a big issue. That's yeah. a really big issue. And that translates into people being able to do better on the leaderboard.
Yeah, I bet. Yeah.
Because they will have a higher Paragon level, because they can skip the rifting and the trials and the bounties. Mm-hmm. They will have better items than you, most likely, because in its essence, the more you play Diablo 3, the better items you get. Pretty yeah. much. I mean, yeah. a lot of playtime is just countering RNG,
yeah.
random number regeneration, regenerator. Mm-hmm. And that's just such a big issue in the competitive scene. Right now, where you see people with double your playtime, and you just feel like you cannot do anything against it.
Yeah, to catch up to them. I mean, it's basically.
I feel by playing fair that I'm being punished.
Yeah.
Inefficiency.
Yeah, which should definitely not be the case. So yeah.
No. No.
To all the botters, guys, I don't know, man. Don't want to say something nasty to you. I try not to, but come on, man. But hopefully, mainly it's our community. I mean, our people that make the game do something about it. Hopefully, in the next patch when they release, if they can, as I think we were talking earlier, Nats, that there could be like a ban wave or something. If someone is botting, and it is illegal. It's not technically illegal. It's actually
that's against the term of service, I think.
Exactly, the game states that clearly. And if someone's doing that, and to guys, you know, my friends here who are very competitive about this, then you know, it's not fair. And I think you know, it just puts a bad name to the game in general. Yeah. So I think
if they just did a bot ban wave mm-hmm. at the end of every season, like a 2 week to a week before the season ends,
yeah.
every season, I think that would take yeah. a huge, like a lot of botters to just not do it
mm-hmm.
because all your work will be for nothing.
Yeah.
In that sense. And I think that fear would really reduce the, you know,
yeah, let's hope really they do that. I completely support that.
I really hope it's not as undetectable as it seems right now.
Yeah, that's also an issue.
Mm-hmm.
The detectability. I mean, you can look at somebody's playtime and say, oh man, you play 16 hours a day, you're botting. But that might not be the case, because some people really, really
love
Diablo 3 and they play 16 hours a day. So that's, you cannot just determine it by that.
Wow, okay. Well, a bit of a dark topic to end, but an important one nonetheless, really, guys. So, yeah, if you know someone, I guess that's the kind of thing, your job to report. And, you know, as us being community members, yeah, we are bringing it to your attention. And hopefully our amazing developers and content creators and other people who, you know, who have a part to play in this, I think they should definitely stop, and hopefully it will. So That's that guy. So yep. To end this thing, I think I'm just going to ask a casual question, guys. And it kind of does make, and it will fit the whole theme of the whole talk we had today, is more of a, to show how these two guys had a different start, yet they have the same mentality about the game because they both love the game at its very core. They're both mates out of luck and out of race cars, by the way. We still haven't talked about the race car.
maybe we keep the mystery going.
Yeah, let's keep the mystery going. Deadset and his race car. But yeah, guys, you know, to end this, I would like to know what's one thing or a couple of things even you'd like to see from Diablo in future. And let's keep it slightly interesting, guys. I'm putting you on spot because I didn't give you time to prepare for this or any of the other topics we had previously, but especially on this one. And that is there anything you're looking forward to to be added into the game? What's one big thing you as a player would like to see? It could be completely selfish. It could be something like, I don't know, I want Barbarian to have five arms or something. To anything, you know, logical. You know, the whole playground is ours. So, Deadset, any ideas, man? Any thoughts on what you'd like to see added in the future for the game?
Well, I think character fantasies have been established, and it's time to break the rules.
Okay.
In a way, have classes wield powers they have previously been reserved to other classes. I know they consciously try not to homogenize classes and have them maybe clash with each other's quote-unquote fantasies, but it would be pretty fun to see a crusader with a crossbow, I think, or a barb with a wand in hand. I don't know. I think it's the Path of Exile speaking right now, but really, it could be interesting to mix things up like that, or have, you know, something mechanical. Let's say something a little, you know, more realistic. Why is there not a single set in the game that interacts with passives? Huh?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Not
wow.
a single one. Not a single item and not a single set in the game interacts with passives in
Definitely.
Any way.
There you go. Black or Invokers. Change that to a passive.
Well, I think Ooh. They talked about Invoker being like a Crusader only set. I read it in some posts.
Patch 2.4.
Yeah. But hey, correct. Blackthorns, right? And all the other sets. They're the craftable sets.
Hey.
Yeah. It's lovely that they don't remove Invokers for every class until it's reworked. No, let's just give it to Crusader. Amazing.
Yep. Thanks. Gee.
Yeah. Enjoy the lovely graphics of tones coming out of your shoulder and stuff.
Yes.
It's very manly.
With the 4,000 damage.
With the 4,000 damage per hit. Monsters are like, are you serious, bro? Are you actually using it?
Some bosses have trillions of health. It's like 4K. That's good.
4K damage reflection. What about you, Nats? Anything you'd like to see added into the game? Anything reasonable or non-reasonable? Everything.
Well, kind of what I discussed earlier, just some rune revamps. I think it's very boring for a regenerator to, now it's changed to fire.
Mm-hmm.
But the other one is changed to physical and stuns. Or
okay.
This rune changes to physical and it reduces the cooldown. Or this one does holy AoE damage. I think there's a very kind of very interesting runes and also very boring runes out there or boring passives that are so outdated. Like looking at vanilla where they didn't even matter back then. And then you look at them and I was like, why would I ever pick this passive?
Mm-hmm.
Why does it exist? So I would really like them to kind of look at every class, kind of look at the runes. Okay, what's outdated? What can we buff? What can we change to make it more interesting? Mm-hmm. Not necessarily so much better, but just, I don't know, make it cool. Make it something you want to use for a certain build that might not even be that good, but it's just for build diversity that just makes your character look awesome with a certain rune change.
Yeah, choice. Yeah.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
So that's maybe something I would like to see. And of course, a new class introduced in the expansion. I really hope there is a new expansion coming. I think Diablo is, I think it's never been as popular as it is now.
Definitely,
I think they're going in a very good direction with adding a lot of new content.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of unexpected content, right?
Yeah.
We just talked about Cube there. Who expected something like that
I did not. I honestly, I would have played Season 4 with just the removal of Trials. Honestly, it's anything added is just a bonus.
Yeah. Good. So since you brought up the issue, I'm not going to let you pass on to this. Last question, quick one is, I'll ask everyone this, and that is the new class that's going to be added. what do you think, what would you like to see as the next class? Any crazy ideas, anything, something silly, like I gave a silly example, and that's like a shapeshifter, like a druid, but I don't want him to be a druid. I want him to be like a Native American themed guy, someone who turns into a jaguar or something. So yeah, he's a shapeshifter, but he's got these cool, that's like my little fantasy. I'd love to see a character, because every character in Diablo represents, first of all, you know, and a Deadset is a lore guy, he would probably explain this in a better way than I would, is before they create anything, a Diablo team, they like to think about the fantasy of how a character is and what their personality would be, you know? As they said, monk is like an Indian Chinese monk mixed with a Russian Rasputin style, you know, with a big beard going and a bald head.
Yeah.
And he's a guy who, like Natsuma said in the beginning, he liked to punch things and, you know, hit him in the face. It's lightning speed thing. And hence monk was born, and he was one of the new characters. And wizard is all about casting spells, being brilliant. And that brilliance brought a bit of cockiness. And you can get that from a dialogue. Demon hunter are all dark. They're very squishy. They're very slithery. You know, they come in, kill, run out before anything happens. So this team has to fit, and that's the beauty of D3 creators. They come up with these things, and it all starts at the lore, you know. It starts at this whole feel of a character, and that's why I think something like rather than having an Amazonian, you know, archer or something, or like a druid, or even like a necromancer, personally I would like to see something like that, a shapeshifter, but he's slightly different.
No.
Anyways, that's my choice. So what about you, Nats? Anything you'd like to see?
Yeah, I'm going to go continue with the shapeshifter trend,
mm-hmm.
But more of a Nephilim that got captured by maybe Asmodan or somebody that likes to experiment. So a Nephilim got captured by demons, got experimented on,
mm-hmm.
with just injecting demon blood or just extreme awful things. And that person managed to get so powerful from those experiments that he escaped, and is thus able to shapeshift into demons instead of animals.
Nice.
So I would really like to see that kind of darkness coming from the Nephilim, but still having that kind of human feel of good and evil in him, so he can use that against
righteousness. Yeah. Okay.
Yes. Yeah. I would really like to see something like that.
I know you're into tentacles and stuff. Watch that stuff all the time.
Oh god.
Yeah.
Okay, so there we
go. Did you have some race cars to sit in, dude?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, we learned two things if you learned anything, and that's, you know, Deadset likes cars and Natsuma likes tentacles. Mm. You put them together, you get this podcast, guys. So what about you, Deadset man? I think you're gonna give a cool answer, and that would be like the question would be for, you know, the class. What do you expect to see?
Race car
naturally.
Mm-hmm.
A continuation of something we haven't seen since Diablo 1. I mean, the bard has to make a reappearance, I'm pretty sure.
Okay, so what will be the powers of something like, you know, singing songs and things like that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You should be one to be excited about that. Exactly, exactly. You should be one to be excited about singing.
About singing. Hey, I don't sing. I write poems, okay? It's a very manly thing, guys, all right?
Mm.
I don't sing songs. But yeah, okay. Sounds good. I'm up for that, you know. We're going to call him something, yeah. Something hermity. Sounds good. But anyways, guys, I think this was our podcast. I'd like to thank my friends. It's all us, our adventure, you know, our venture and everything, all else combined into one this little and our almost 2-hour long talk we had today. So thank you guys for showing up. Thank you from my side, guys, to you who are listening to us right now. Do leave your feedback. Tell us what you think about this. Any thoughts, what we covered, anything you'd like to see in future, any questions you have for us, please do leave them. We're going to make this available at different places. We're going to try and, you know, share this video to most of you people as possible, and we're going to try and get it out there. So it's all a little experiment from us, and I hope you all enjoyed it. I know I enjoyed talking to my friends here, and it's been awesome. So from my side,
pleasure.
Thank you, guys. I'll let you guys finish the podcast.
Thank you for having me on the podcast. I always like to talk about Diablo related issues, and I think it was very refreshing and nice to be able to kind of relax and just talk about stuff and, you know, share some personal things that you might not be able to share in YouTube videos or on stream.
Mm-hmm.
And just thank you for allowing me to ramble and share my thoughts on things and listening.
Great. It was great to have you. Deadset, anything you want to talk about? Anything, last words?
I share the same sentiments. I've always maintained that Diablo didn't have, for a long time, a place for community members and community figures to express opinions and maybe get their points across better than they normally do on their own. So I guess if we maintain that the truth is born in discussion, I think there's a lot more and great things to come if we keep making those. I would love to.
All right. Well, thank you, guys. This was it from us, a podcast without a name. We do have a name, by the way, so let's see how this all goes. I hope you all like it. This has been all three of us from our side, and we'll catch you in the next one. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.